my thoughts on the finale of Game of Thrones today on Dungeon Craft. If you enjoy this content, subscribe and hit the bell icon for future updates. Thank you. Welcome to Dungeon Craft. I'm Professor Dungeon Master, coming to you from Dungeon University, and this channel is about running the ultimate game of Dungeons & Dragons. And today we're talking about the finale of Game of Thrones. The popularity of the Lord of the Rings movies and Game of Thrones, I believe, is largely responsible for this resurgence in D&D. So today I'm wearing my plus one vest of protection because a few weeks ago I did a review of the Avengers and it was not favorable. And it got 2,000 downvotes and I lost 27 subscribers. And I have a feeling my thoughts on this video, judging by what I've seen on the internet, it's not going to be popular either. I'm a glutton for punishment, so I'm going to do it again. And the first thing we're going to do is revisit my predictions. And I'll include a link to up there or there to the video if you want to watch the whole thing. But this is what I said a few weeks ago. Arya was going to kill the Night King. Check. Clegane Bowl happened. Yes. The Hound saved Arya one last time. He did. Cersei and Jaime died in each other's arms. Tyrion lived and had a hand in creating a new government. Out of 19 predictions, I got 12 right and 7 wrong, some of them really wrong, including who ultimately sat on the Iron Throne. But in the end, I was satisfied. Yes, I have some minor quibbles, which I'm going to discuss. Yes, there were some embarrassing continuity errors, but let's face it, what show doesn't have that? All in all, I thought it was good. Nearly perfect in terms of story, but somewhat flawed in terms of execution, which I'll get into later. Of course, it was an ending that had a twist that disappointed a lot of people, particularly parents that named their children Daenerys. But it's my favorite kind of twist, the one that I didn't see coming, but in retrospect, all the clues were there all along. One of my favorite things about George R.R. Martin's writing, if you haven't read the books, is the change of viewpoint characters. The Game of Thrones world is morally gray, and we're always changing viewpoints, seeing events from different viewpoints, and it changes our perception of them. When I first read about Bran being pushed out that window by Jaime, I hated Jaime, and then I sympathized with him. I began to see his redemption arc and his heroic qualities. I felt compassion the way he died, protecting his sister. I love that image of them standing on that map of the world while the world literally crumbles all around them. They came into the world together, they go out of the world together, and I was touched by the scene where Brienne finishes the book and finishes his story and says he died protecting his queen. I know why some people were disappointed with Cersei's death, because it denies the audience catharsis. We really wanted to see someone stick a knife in her so she could get her comeuppance. But the way I saw it, it was a really miserable death. Her children are dead, her brothers have abandoned her, everyone's abandoned her. She has nothing left except the city, and it's destroyed street by street by this dragon, and all she can do is watch helplessly. She is completely broken, she's completely crushed emotionally and then physically. So I felt that was, to me, a catharsis. And it was a death which was, in the end, she's so desperate and pitiful, I felt pity for her. Some part of this dissatisfaction stems from the fact that the season was so short. But Game of Thrones has 71 episodes, of which the final season comprises 6. That's less than 10% of the total story time. If you see a Shakespeare play and it's 2 hours long, the last 10 minutes of it is there's no character development, there's no plots. It's just all resolution. I just saw King Lear on Broadway with Game of Thrones actor Pedro Pascal, and 5 characters die in the last 10 minutes of the play. Now, with the big twist with Daenerys, I didn't predict it, but I should have seen it coming because the clues were all there. She says, "When my dragons are grown, we will take back what was stolen from me and destroy those who wronged me. We will lay waste to armies and burn cities to the ground." My emphasis on the word me. She really cares only about herself. She has a huge ego and a messiah complex, which is why she reminds us she is the protector of realms, the breaker of chains, and the mother of dragons. Dictators fashion themselves as protectors and liberators. They claim they're the champions of the people, and they'll say they are delivering them from oppression, but in reality, Daenerys is an autocrat, a fascist, and a sociopath. Sociopaths see themselves as the ultimate arbiters of morality. She crucifies people, she burns people alive, she buries her handmaiden alive. She embraces the Targaryen motto of fire and blood. She burns the Tarleys alive. Without the benefit of a trial or representation, she is judge, jury, and executioner. She justifies it to Tyrion by saying they chose this, as if she was giving them a choice. But that's just not taking responsibility for her actions. She did have a choice. She chose to burn them. Yes, she frees slaves. But look, the Bolsheviks, Mao, Stalin, Che Guevara, Fidel Castro, and every other tyrant fashion themselves as the breakers of chains and the champions of the common people. But eventually, they end up totalitarian and their regimes end up worse than the ones they toppled. That's the brilliance of Martin's writing. Because she's a viewpoint character, we get into her head and we start rooting for her. We cheer for her as she crucifies people and burns others to death. We assume it's hyperbole when she says she's going to burn cities. Like Tyrion and Jon Snow, we're beguiled by her because of her charm and her beauty. And like them, we realize too late that she's a tyrant. For many people, this came out of nowhere. Like that scene in The Bells where she nukes everybody and people said she went all Mad Queen. She didn't go Mad Queen. That was deliberately planned. Tyrion asked her to wait for the bells, that if the bells ring, that the King's Landing will have surrendered and she'll be able to avoid the bloodshed. But she never responds to Tyrion. We assume that she was going to agree with the plan. But in fact, she was planning to nuke the people all along. Being betrayed by Varys, Tyrion, Jon did not push her over the edge. It merely confirmed what she already thought and knew at that Winterfell celebration, that she couldn't rule through love like Jon could. She could only rule through fear. This is reflected in the imagery where she's gone from wearing white gowns, symbolizing her innocence, to full black leather dominatrix wear with back devil wings. So Jon had no choice but to kill her. It's Martin's answer to everyone who expected a happy ending. Game of Thrones was never heroic fantasy. It was always a tragedy, and it needs to have a tragic ending. And Jon knifing Daenerys, it's operatic, and it's the only ending that could have occurred. It's the most tragic ending we could imagine. That shot of the Iron Throne in the ruined castle with the ashes snowing around it, that's the perfect image. Everything is destroyed, but the Iron Throne, the lure of power, is still there, tempting Daenerys. The way she caresses the throne with her finger, but the ability of the throne to corrupt people's minds and hearts, it's still alive. Martin's central idea, his theme, is that absolute power corrupts absolutely. That's why Drogon destroys the throne, because he realizes at a primal level that it was Daenerys' thirst for power, her desire for that throne, that ultimately destroyed her. Not Jon Snow. We should have also expected the end. If you've read Joseph Campbell's The Hero with a Thousand Faces, Jon is the Campbellian monomyth character, right? He has the hero's journey. Martin is a big fan of saying he wanted to smash the Campbellian monomyth, and he kind of does that with killing Ned early on in book one, but Jon is definitely following the hero's journey. He goes on a journey. He meets a mentor, Mormont, who gives him the sword, a boon, Valyrian steel. He crosses the threshold when he leaves the wall and goes beyond it and encounters the wildlings. He goes on a road of trials. He's killed. He's resurrected. He eventually triumphs. But he can't go home again because he's been changed. In the Campbellian monomyth, either the hero chooses not to stay home or is rejected by the very people he tried to save. And that's what happens to Jon. Like Frodo at the end of Lord of the Rings, the movie, he says, "Sam, we saved the Shire, but not for me." And that's why Frodo joins Elrond and Gandalf and sails across the sea. Similarly, Jon is exiled north, but I'm not even sure that that's a sad ending for him. He was always at home with the wildlings more than the civilized people, and from what he's seen of all the carnage, I don't think he ever wanted to be king. Moreover, he knows that it's only by stepping down and breaking that cycle that will really break the wheel. If Jon and Dany had had a happy ending and they had had a bunch of children, this blood feud would continue. And there'd be no reason, if we ended it there, right where it began with the Targaryen on the throne, then the sect would just repeat itself. For it really to be meaningful and impactful, it had to end that way with the cycle being broken. And Jon Snow was the only one who could have done it. As for Bran becoming king, the first thing I did when the show ended was I went to my bookshelf and I pulled off this copy of Game of Thrones, my old copy, and I looked at the first viewpoint character, and it was Bran. The books start with Bran and end with Bran. The story has come full circle. The predominant story in the books is the story of the Stark children, and they start as
nobles, and they lose everything. They lose their father, their mother, their brother. They lose their castle. They're ground down. They're forced into servitude, into slavery, and they come back. It is a comeback story of how the Starks rise again stronger than they were before. Sansa goes from a spoiled girl, not naive and not interested in politics, to being a wise and a powerful leader. Arya starts as a helpless child and ends up a master assassin. That's why I had no problem with her killing the Night King, and I predicted it, because why else would she go through all that training? Those pieces had to fit together. Martin's ideal king, ideal ruler, is dispassionate and not concerned with the trappings of power. Bran is incorruptible, and that's why he would be the perfect king. For those who say if Bran knew the future, then he had to know that Daenerys was going to commit mass genocide. So by doing that, he's the real villain. Not really. He knew that Jon was the only one in the position to kill Daenerys, and Jon wouldn't have done that unless those deaths occurred. Furthermore, the Three-Eyed Raven can see far into the future all the peaceful lives that will be created because of Jon's decision. All right, so my criticisms. I did wonder why Grey Worm would take Jon Snow prisoner at the beginning. He's slitting people's throats because they crossed his queen. Was he just going to throw Jon Snow in a prison cell? That doesn't make sense, and I'm going to want to see more of how, why that is in the books. I also wonder why Daenerys didn't just nuke Tyrion when she had the chance. Why throw him in a jail cell? What is she, giving him a trial? She hasn't given anyone else a trial. She's just letting him stay alive to cause trouble. So one of my friends said that, well, that's because he was the closest to her, but that's something I would want to see fleshed out in the books more. Those are my thoughts on Game of Thrones. Do you agree? Do you disagree? Like or dislike, and put a comment below. If you haven't subscribed to this channel, you really should, because a bunch of people will probably unsubscribe, so I just want to even it out. As always, this has been Professor Dungeon Master for Dungeoncraft. Thanks for watching, I'll see you at the table, and may all your rolls be 20s.
If you enjoyed today's content, click the Dungeon Door logo to subscribe to the channel and the bell icon to receive notifications. And be sure to follow us on Twitter, @DungeonCraft.